Welcome to the 2020 NATS Virtual National Conference and to this event. I'm Alan Henderson, Executive Director of NATS, and today NATS is pleased to present the 2020 NATS Lifetime Achievement Award. At every conference, we bestow the NATS Lifetime Achievement Award upon a person who has made significant contributions to our art form. In past years, NATS has recognized Florence Henderson, Joan Boyden, Marvin Kinsey, George Shirley, and Virginia Tseani. Before the formalization of this award, the association also honored Marnie Nixon and Simon Estes. Had our national conference occurred live and in person, we would have been graced by the radiant presence of this year's honoree, internationally acclaimed opera singer, film and television star, and hometown Knoxvillian, Mary Costa.
You hear that, Samson? Beautiful. What is it? Come on, let's find out.
Ladies and gentlemen, the lovely Miss Mary Costa.
Well, look, stick around while I introduce Mary Costa, will you?
No. Mary Costa? Mary Costa?
Yeah, Mary Costa. She's a wonderful singer.
Well, you mean the beautiful opera star? You couldn't say John Wayne or somebody like that. That'd be Mary Costa?
It's Mary Costa, yeah. She's here. As a matter of fact, you introduce her, okay? You take over the bill. Go ahead.
The Hollywood Palace is proud to present the girl who was such a smashing success in New York a few weeks ago. Acclaimed by critics and audiences alike for her performance as Violetta in La Traviata, and who made beautiful Metropolitan Opera House even more beautiful.
Mary Costa, ladies and gentlemen.
Mary Costa!
Package and show one of the most startling features of the 1956 cars from Chrysler Corporation. For the first time on any car, push-button driving.
On the instrument panel of every Chrysler Corporation car with power flight.
Oh, push-button driving. Who'd ever think of it?
Well, Chrysler Corporation, of course.
And they thought of many, many more wonderful things in the 56 Chrysler Corporation cars.
Supposed to speak to strangers, but we've met before.
I know you. I walked with you once upon a dream. I know you. The gleam in your eyes is so familiar, a gleam, yet I know it's true.
that visions are seldom all they seem. But if I know you, I know what you'll do. You'll love me at once, the way you did once upon a dream.
Just a few years ago, a beautiful young actress was riding the crest of a very promising career in television. And then one day, Jack Benny heard her vocalizing and was so impressed that he urged her to have a go at a singing career. And right then and there, television lost a mighty good actress. And then what happened, you might ask? Well, if you'll wait a second, you'll find out.
That was beautiful, Mary.
Now he won't walk, he walked and he fiddled and he fiddled and he walked and he drank till he died. But I've heard tell when the wind is down and the moon shines bright and the leaves are brown, you can hear old Ebo fiddling all around.
Ebo Walker was a good old man.
Jangling all of the way.
You're know, I've been in the music business for, well, quite a long while, but you hit notes that I didn't know existed.
Oh, gee, that's great. Thank you, Bing.
This is the happiest day of my life. Everything's so wonderful. Oh, I just love happy endings.
In 1952, Costa was personally chosen by Walt Disney to be the speaking and singing voice of Princess Aurora in the Disney film Sleeping Beauty. The Disney classic was 7 years in production, during which period Costa became the female spokesperson, serving alongside William Lundigan and Jack Benny on CBS's duo Climax and the Shower of Stars. Costa's Metropolitan Opera debut in 1964 received one of the season's greatest ovations and engendered enthusiastic praise from critics. It is considered one of the most outstanding debuts of an American singer in the history of the company. Mary performed a number of leading roles with the Metropolitan in succeeding seasons, including Massenet's Manon, her favorite role. She was subsequently chosen by Samuel Barber and Giancarlo Menotti to recreate the title role in a new production of Barber's opera, Vanessa. One of Costa's favorite remembrances was being chosen by Igor Stravinsky for the role of Anne Truelove in the San Francisco Opera's production of the new work, The Rake's Progress, which prior to its opening included an unforgettable 3 weeks of private vocal coaching in the Stravinsky home. Also considered a special occasion was the invitation to perform the world premiere of Norman De La Gioia's Blood Moon and the Western Hemisphere production of Benjamin Britten's A Midsummer Night's Dream. Mary's choice to sing at the Bolshoi Opera in 1970 during her first tour of Russia was a performance of La Traviata, and the Russians loved her. She made such an impact on the audiences that she was asked to extend her 2-week trip to 13 weeks in order for audiences all over Russia to hear her. This was an unprecedented triumph at the time for an American singer. In 1971, at the request of Leonard Bernstein, Costa sang the lead in a revival of Candide, which opened the opera house at the new Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. She performed the role for an extended run. After seeing her in Candide, producer Andrew Stone cast Costa as the wife of Johann Strauss Jr. in the 1972 MGM film, The Great Waltz, for which she was nominated for a Golden Globe Award. Her personal flair and natural affinity for Viennese music resulted in many highly acclaimed Viennese concerts across the USA. In the latter part of the 1990s, Mary divided her time between personal appearances for the Disney Corporation and a demanding schedule of motivational speaker engagements. In 1998, Tennessee Governor Don Sundquist presented Mary with the Tennessee Achievement Award for her contributions to the arts and her constant inspiration to young people throughout the country. And in the same year, she was asked to be one of the individuals to choose the music for a classical CD that is presented to every child born in the state of Tennessee. In 1999, she was the recipient of the coveted Disney Legends Award. Much of her motivational enthusiasm was and still continues to be directed towards primary, secondary, and college level students. Her association with the Walt Disney Corporation as the voice of Sleeping Beauty has afforded her the opportunity to raise funds on behalf of many beloved charities. On February 5th, 2003, Costa was nominated by President George Bush to serve on the National Council of the Arts from 2003 to 2006. The Walt Disney Studios released the 50th anniversary platinum edition of Sleeping Beauty in 2008. It was the first full-length Disney animated feature to come to Blu-ray disc. Remember those? Honoring the 1959 debut of the original film. Costa was asked to make personal appearances at numerous venues, including special functions in New York City, Los Angeles, and London. During the month of October of 2008, she was invited to return to the National Endowment of the Arts to present the first NEA Opera Honors Award to her longtime friend, Leontine Price. Costa was later a recipient of one of the Governor's Arts Awards in the category of Distinguished Artists in March of 2015. Costa continues to be actively involved in mentoring and encouraging young vocalists. Here's a video of the presentation made when Costa was awarded one of the Governor's Arts Awards.
I know you, I walked with you once upon a dream. I know you.
As the beloved Princess Aurora, Mary Costa brought her voice and personality to the 1959 Disney classic Sleeping Beauty and emerged as an international artist who has graced the stages of opera, concert, theater, television, and movies.
Walt Disney called me and he said, "You have a warm, warm voice, and it expresses love from your heart. Also, your voice is so naturally placed that you can use your singing voice as an extension of speech."
I wonder why each little bird has a someone.
And he said, "I want you to drop all of the colors and the things that you feel about Briar Rose to your vocal palette, and I want you to paint with your voice."
She was really an operatic singer, and she proved it later by singing with the Metropolitan Opera.
Very beautiful lady. Actually, I think Mark kind of used her as a model.
In a stellar career that included performances in 38 operas, she premiered roles for many of the greatest composers of the era. She has performed in all of the world's top opera houses, including the Metropolitan Opera, the Royal Opera House at Covent Garden, the Bolshoi Theater, and the San Francisco Opera. She earned the Licia Albanese Puccini Foundation Lifetime Achievement Award in 1989 and was appointed by President George W. Bush to serve on the National Council on the Arts. Mary Costa performed with TV stars and radio personalities such as Bing Crosby, Frank Sinatra, Don Knotts, and Jack Benny.
And so my beloved, when red leaves are fall.
She was also asked by First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy to sing at President John F. Kennedy's memorial service. Years later, at the request of Leonard Bernstein, Miss Costa sang the lead in a revival of Candide, which opened the Opera House at the new Kennedy Center in Washington. Despite her international fame, Miss Costa's roots have always been in Tennessee. She was recently awarded an honorary doctorate of humane and musical letters from the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of Tennessee.
Mary's been very, very supportive of the music school. She has done really everything that we've asked her to do, but she's never really said, "You need me to do this." She's the consummate professional when it comes to that. She's always there to help. when she is asked, but she's never supposing that we need to be calling on her. So the School of Music is grateful to have her as a friend, and we're thrilled that she is willing to help us whenever she can.
She also helped found the Knoxville Opera in 1979, which has grown into one of Tennessee's major cultural institutions.
But without Mary Costa, there would have been no Knoxville Opera Company, and that is what is critical for us here 37 years later. Millions and millions of people, including children, have been touched by what this opera company has been able to give to the community. And without Mary, and without her vision, and without her generosity, to start this opera company on a great foot, there would be no Knoxville Opera, and we wouldn't be sitting here 37 years later celebrating what she has done for us and for the entire community.
I am originally from Knoxville, Tennessee, and of course when you have, when you sing, you don't sing with an accent.
Yeah.
But I talk like this.
In the same way that she signs her name, Princess Aurora, when sending letters to sick children in need of a smile, Ms. Costa has used her talent and dedication to make a difference in the lives of all those she has touched and continues to shine a beautiful light on Knoxville and the state of Tennessee.
Her personality is like the sun. I mean, I think the sun might have gotten its personality from Mary if Mary had come first, because Mary is that bright. I mean, there's never a room that she enters that isn't better because she's there. And when she leaves, wasn't better because she was there. So, I mean, she really is an amazing human being. Like I said, when you speak with her, you know that that moment and that day at that time, that's the most important thing to her.
And so NATS presents its 2020 NATS Lifetime Achievement Award to Mary Costa. Mary is heeding her doctor's safer at home suggestion and has submitted the following comments.
Heartfelt gratitude and deepest admiration to all of you in the National Association of Teachers of Singing. When I was told that I was going to receive this Lifetime Award, I was deeply touched because I knew I would have the opportunity on behalf of all of your students to thank you for using your unique keys of wisdom, sensitivity, and understanding to help unlock our innate creativity. You touch our hearts and our inner spirits in a special way, which allows us to bring joy, inspiration, and hope to audiences throughout the world. The sincere and genuine relationship between a teacher and their student weaves a beautiful tapestry of kindred hearts and minds. We find guidance from you in developing our own unique production of sound. You are a true friend with whom we can reveal our innermost self in times of need. And one of our greatest champions and encouragers in our moments of success. I am receiving this award in the year of my 90th birthday. Good. My life has taken me on a long musical journey, and I would like to recapture just a few of those memories. My mother, Hazel Costa, who lived to be 101, was guided throughout her life by her devotion to her faith in God and her joy of serving others. She was asked many times, "When did Mary start to sing?" And she would always reply, "Mary arrived in this world making an abundance of sound, and fortunately, through the years, it became better and better." From early childhood, singing was so personal to me that I only sang while playing in my sandbox and for my parents. My daddy would offer me dimes and quarters to sing for his friends, but that just didn't work. The first time I truly wanted to sing for a group of people was when I was 5 years old and attending church with my mother. We always sat just behind the rows reserved for the class of the deaf in our church, and I became fascinated with the wonderful woman who was signing because her facial expressions showed how she was feeling inside. Although I didn't understand what her hands were saying, I have never forgotten her passion and love in delivering her message. Every Sunday I would go and speak to her, and one Sunday she asked me if I would sing for her Sunday school class because she had watched me enthusiastically singing the hymns with my mother. The following Sunday, my mother took me to her classroom and I sang Jesus Loves Me unaccompanied. As if it were yesterday, I can still see all of them smiling as I sang and clapping at the end of my song. Oh, from that moment on, I felt in my heart that I could make people happy with my singing. That small child who was so curious and sensitive about everything still lives in me and can remember my parents' joy in answering all of my incessant questions. They were both creative and musical, so my early years were filled with a myriad of sounds in all styles of music and dramatic activities through puppet shows and plays performed with other children in the neighborhood, which incidentally were written and directed by my beloved daddy. My childhood enthusiasm for performing continued until I was 15, when my parents and I moved from Tennessee to California. This move was the result of a trip we took to Los Angeles to visit my father's sisters. During our time there, a dinner party was given by my aunts, and Mrs. Leland Atherton Irish, a woman very prominent in musical circles, was invited. When we finished dinner, I was asked to sing. Mrs. Irish was so surprised and delighted with my voice that she immediately suggested to my parents that they should consider moving to Glendale, California, because Glendale High School was known for its advanced musical presentations. She told them that she would be able to have me released from my last two classes of the day to attend the Los Angeles Conservatory of Music. My parents took her advice, and in just 3 months, we moved. Because I was the youngest student at the conservatory, the coaches felt that my voice was naturally placed. So they suggested that I concentrate on learning languages and work with a private coach who would help me prepare classical art songs, German Lieder, and suitable operatic arias to be sung for performances in the conservatory recitals. I graduated from Glendale High School when I was 18, and 2 years later from the Los Angeles Conservatory of Music. Following that, I auditioned for Walt Disney and was chosen to sing the role of the Princess Aurora in the animated film Sleeping Beauty. In 1955, I became a spokesperson for the Chrysler Corporation and a co-host for the CBS television drama Climax and a variety show, The Shower of Stars, which featured the comedian Jack Benny. There were portable dressing rooms for each of us outside the soundstage. I could hear Jack practicing his violin in his dressing room, and he could hear me vocalizing in mine. One day, he complimented me on my voice. He knew I was singing for Disney, but on the television commercials, I was only using my speaking voice. After asking me what I would like to accomplish in the future, I told him I thought I would really like to become an opera singer. I wanted to study with a voice teacher, but I didn't know who to call. He said he knew of two fantastic teachers who lived in Los Angeles, and both of them had sung with the Metropolitan Opera. Then he left for a few moments and came back with their names and telephone numbers. After I returned home, I called the first teacher, but the line was busy. So I called the second one. And Mario Chomley answered the phone. He was so cheerful and told me that his studio was in his home and that he taught with his wife, Ruth Miller Chomley, who also had sung with the Metropolitan Opera. I made an appointment to sing for them and chose Rossini's Una Voce Poco Fa from The Barber of Seville because I had sung it so many times at the conservatory. When I completed the aria, they both smiled and applauded. Mario said, "I like the sound of your voice. It is fresh and unique. We want to keep it that way, so I am going to teach you how to breathe, because singing is breathing, and you do not know how to breathe." Laughing, he said, "I would be happy to teach you in my studio, young lady, if you will promise that from the time you come in until the time you leave, you will never let me hear you breathe again." Oh, pardon me. I'm sorry. I meant breathe an audible breath again. "You will take quick breaths and deep breaths, but," he said, "I don't want to hear them." And then he doubled over with laughter. He was so honest and so much fun that I became silent for a moment, never taking my eyes off of him. And taking a resounding deep breath, I said, "All right. As long as I can breathe normally everywhere else." And he said, "No." And he broke into laughter. And we laughed all the way to his front door. I started taking three lessons a week, and within a year, Jack Benny asked me to appear as a guest on the Shower of Stars variety show. I sang Un Bel Di from Madame Butterfly, and many people wrote in asking him the name of the person that had dubbed in my singing voice, since they had never heard me sing on the Chrysler commercials. From that time on, I was invited to perform all over Los Angeles in many different venues. One day when I arrived for my lesson with Mario and Ruth, they were extremely animated. They could hardly wait to tell me that NATS, the National Association of Teachers of Singing, had called them and wanted them to bring me with them to their luncheon of the year at the Biltmore Hotel. They had heard about me and wanted to hear me sing. The Chomleys had been members of NATS for years and were so excited. I, on the other hand, became so nervous that I said, "Oh no, I couldn't do that. They're all so perfect, and I certainly am not. No, I'm just not ready to do that now." Mario laughed and said, "They will enjoy listening to you. You must do it." They both looked at me with such expectation that I said, "Well, okay, I will." We chose Handel's O Had I Jubal's Lyre and Puccini's O Mio Babbino Caro. When we arrived at the hotel for the Nats luncheon, we walked to the ballroom. I thought that there must be at least 100 tables in there, and the piano was placed so that everyone could see and hear me perfectly. I was too nervous to eat lunch, and Mario kept saying things to make me smile. I looked at him and Ruth and realized that my teachers had become like family to me. When I was introduced, I walked to the piano with Clyde Lehman, the studio accompanist. The audience had read my choices in the program and welcomed me with smiles and applause. Those smiles instantly relaxed me. So I turned and nodded to my accompanist. I sang, and they never stopped smiling. When the first aria was completed, they gave me a hearty applause. And at the end of the Puccini aria, they clapped so long that Mario walked to the piano and told the accompanist to prepare to play Una Voce Poco Fa. He told the audience that this was the first aria I had sung for him, and he wanted me to sing it for them. I sang with complete joy because I wanted to please my audience. At the end of the aria, I sang a good F above high C, and they gave me a standing ovation. I have shared this story with you, dear teachers, because I still remember it so vividly. That day, my performance at NATS gave me the inspiration and encouragement I needed to pursue an operatic career. Now, I hope you can see why I really should be sharing this award with you. Teachers play such an important part in all of our lives. And I would like to share a few of the things I was able to accomplish because of my teachers. I have had the joy of performing 39 operas, both in our country and throughout the world. Leonard Bernstein asked me to sing the role of Cunegonda for the American tour of his musical Candide. And 12 years later, he asked me again to sing Cunegonda at the opening of the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts in Washington, D.C. And it was a delight to work with Igor Stravinsky for 2 weeks in his home to prepare the role of Anne Truelove in a new production of The Rake's Progress for the San Francisco Opera. Samuel Barber and Giancarlo Menotti requested that I sing the leading role in a new production of Vanessa at the Metropolitan Opera, and Jacqueline Kennedy called me personally to ask me to sing the Liberame from the Verdi Requiem for President John F. Kennedy's memorial at the Sports Arena in Los Angeles. Through the years, many of my recitals and concerts with orchestra have been hosted by universities, and they almost always asked me to give a masterclass for the music students. That was one of the true highlights of my career. Now I am mentoring and advising young singers and have found that many singers throughout the world have chosen to come to America to study because our teachers strive to bring out the unique qualities of every student by training them to own their uniqueness rather than becoming an imitation of someone else. I have enjoyed reminiscing with you about some of the most memorable events of my career and would like to add something of a more personal nature, which is nothing in this world has been as important to me as my walk with God. Throughout my life, He has been my strength and my song. and he has blessed me to the utmost through my teachers. Robert Louis Stevenson said, "Don't judge each day by the harvest you reap, but by the seeds you plant." As I look back, I am aware of those who planted, as well as those who helped to develop the seeds of destiny in my life. My loving and imaginative parents planted seeds of creativity, understanding, and a positive realization that anything is possible if you believe in yourself and work diligently toward fulfilling your goals. The exuberant teacher of the deaf class in my church planted a seed of understanding in my heart, exemplifying how deeply a visible expression of passion in what you do is both inspiring and contagious to others. As a young singer, my appearance at the NATS luncheon watered the seeds of self-confidence and courage. So many seeds of wisdom and truth have been planted in my life by caring individuals. Teachers have the wonderful opportunity to plant seeds of knowledge and inspiration in the heart of a student, and to water those seeds with enthusiastic encouragement and guidance. Then, to watch as those seeds take root and form the self-confidence and passion a student needs to realize their vision and to develop their goals. You, dear teachers of the National Association of Teachers of Singing, are planters of the seeds of excellence in generations of students. It is with great appreciation and honor that I thank you with all of my heart for this lifetime award.
Of all the performances of Mary Costa's career, the most memorable for her was the Libera Me from the Verdi Requiem that was sung at the JFK Memorial Service, along with the Roger Wagner Chorale and the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra under the direction of Zubin Mehta. Jacqueline Kennedy had requested that Mary sing in this service. With 4 days' notice, Mary learned that aria and sang it for the first time in this very high-profile setting as she helped to lead a nation that was mourning this senseless and tragic loss. Although the 57-year-old video is a little bit grainy and doesn't quite have the audio professional capabilities that we have today, nothing can diminish this palpable sense of sorrow and inexplicable grief that's woven into every thread of the fabric of this performance. Mary Costa, singing Libera Me, 1963.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Mary Costa, accompanied by the Roger Wagner Chorale and the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Mr. Zubin Mehta, in Libera Me, from the Requiem by Giuseppe Verdi.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.